Good morning and welcome to the second meeting in 2021 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether or not to take item 4 in private. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Members have indicated their agreement. I would also like to take this point to indicate to the committee that Patrick Harvey has resigned from the committee. No doubt due to his elevation to ministerial office this afternoon. Although he's only been to two meetings in this session, I'd like to thank Patrick for his contributions to date. Okay, so we will now hear from two separate sets of witnesses. The first panel is from the Scottish Fiscal Commission, with whom we will discuss a number of recently published reports, including their economic and fiscal forecasts. Members have received copies of the reports, along with a private briefing paper from the Financial Scrutiny Unit in Spice. A welcome to the meeting, Dame Susan Rice, DBE, Chair, Professor Alistair Smith, Commissioner, and John Ireland, Chief Executive of the Scottish Fiscal Commission. We're also joined remotely for this session by Professor Francis Breeden, who's also a Commissioner with the SFC. If members have any specific questions for Professor Breeden, or if Dame Susan wishes to bring him in at any point, please make this clear so our broadcasting operators can activate Professor Breeden's microphone. I intend to allow 75 minutes for this session, and before we open up to questions from the committee, I invite Dame Susan Rice to make a short opening statement. Susan.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, and thank you for the invitation this time to give evidence to the committee. I'm joined here in Parliament, as you said, by Professor Alistair Smith and by John Ireland, our Chief Executive, and Francis Breeden joins us remotely. We published our latest economic and fiscal forecast last Thursday following a recommendation from last session's committee. We also published the second part of our forecast evaluation report covering income tax and non-domestic rates. Along with the report we published in July, you now have the full statutory evaluation or annual evaluation of all of our forecasts. Our third and final publication last week was a fiscal update, looking at the evolving budget position for this and the last financial year. We hope these reports will assist the Parliament in its pre-budget scrutiny. We're all struck by the success of the COVID vaccines in weakening the link between case numbers and serious illness. This led to a clear shift in government policy since the January forecast. Even though case numbers have been climbing steeply this month, hospital admissions and deaths remain low, and public health restrictions in Scotland are minimal. We're taking a much more positive outlook for the economy than we did at the start of the year. We now anticipate that GDP will reach its pre-pandemic level by the second quarter of 2022, almost 2 years earlier than we forecast previously. Prospects for long-term recovery are good as well. We've reduced our estimate of long-term scarring or damage to productive capacity to 2%, down from 3% last January. However, there are ongoing risks to recovery. We're all mindful of the current rise in cases and the longer-term possibility that vaccines may not be effective against new variants or that the protection they offer may wane over time. The First Minister is clear that in the event of significant pressures on the NHS, heightened health restrictions would be considered. Many of our tax forecasts have also been revised up significantly since January. This is due to both the improved prospects for the economy and rising inflation. For example, our income tax forecast for this year has been revised up by around £900 million. Let me be clear, though, that this significant increase in expected income tax receipts will not feed into this year's Scottish budget. That element of the budget was fixed earlier in the year using our January forecast, and the offsetting block grant adjustment was set using the OBR's March forecast. This latest estimate of this year's net income tax position, accounting for our new forecast of Scottish receipts and the same block grant adjustment, is £1.3 billion. And this large difference is the result of a significant improvement in the economic outlook between March, when the OBR made their forecast, and now, when we've done ours. There's no evidence of a significant divergence in Scottish and UK economic performance that would support such a high net funding position. So we expect that when the updated OBR forecasts are published in October, the net funding position for income tax will be reduced significantly to and will return to a level similar to previous years. Turning to Social Security, we're predicting that spending on devolved payments will increase from £3.7 billion in 2021-22 to £5.2 billion in 2026-27, as more people receive support each year and payments are uprated by inflation. From next summer, the Scottish Government will gradually be replacing the UK Government's Personal Independence Payment, or PIP, with its own Adult Disability Payment, or ADP. This is a major step in the devolution of Social Security, and for the first time, we've estimated the additional spending. Although there are no changes in the overall structure of the payment, there are changes to the processes for application, review, and appeals, as well as changes in how the payment is communicated. We expect that by 2026-27, spending on ADP will reach £3 billion, which is half a billion pounds higher than would have been spent on PIP. We also expect spending on carers' allowance to increase as more people become eligible through the larger number of adults receiving disability payments. The Scottish Government receives funding from the UK Government based approximately on what would have been spent on PIP in Scotland, so the additional spending on ADP will need to be met by raising taxes or reducing spending elsewhere in Scotland. This forecast is, by its nature, uncertain. It's always difficult to estimate spending on new Social Security payments. In this case, we only have limited information to guide our estimates of how the delivery innovations will affect the caseload and average payments. A reminder, too, that the Scottish Government has other commitments to increase Social Security spending, including doubling Scottish child payment, which we have yet to include in our forecasts. That's all for my comments. Convener, thank you.
Thank you very much. Before I let members of the committee in to ask some questions, I'll have some opening questions, as is going to be the norm in this committee as we go forward. You talked about taxation, and obviously that's of extreme interest to not just the committee and the parliament, but obviously the wider public. And I'm just wondering if you can talk to us a wee bit about the impact of fiscal drag inflation on on taxation as we go forward, and whether or not the Fiscal Commission can quantify specifically the impact of that compared to the increased output as a result of the reduction in COVID pressures.
So I think we could all say something, but I'm wondering, Francis, are you the best place to respond to that question?
Somewhat distant, but maybe I'll
straight in the deep end.
Exactly, that's right. So yes, as you correctly point out, I mean, you know, one of the other things that's changed about the outlook is certainly in the short term significantly higher inflation than anybody was expecting. And that will have fiscal consequences. Now, clearly, most of those sort of come out in the wash in the sense that higher inflation not only increases spending, it also increases revenue. So the net mainly washes out. But you are correct to point out that there is also some fiscal drag. Now, that will mainly be the same for the rest of the UK as for Scotland. And so, again, that's the impact on net position is not so large, but there will be, the inflation will generate effectively more real revenues. It will mainly be illusory, just nominal, but there will be a little bit of a real gain if higher inflation either occurs over a long period.
And this will, of course, mean that more people will become higher taxpayers than is currently the situation.
There is uprating of the thresholds, or most of the thresholds, so some of that will be offset.
Okay, thank you. Spice has produced an interesting document. You may have seen it being touched on in the press, which is basically, it says here that some that because of the Scottish Government's tax policy, some £500 million was raised in taxation, but only £148 million of that benefited the Scottish budget due to block grant adjustments. And we have obviously a Spice explanation here, but I'm wondering if you can touch on that a wee bit for the record.
Alistair, do you want to? Yeah.
Yes, it's a very interesting report. And a valuable piece of work. It however, is addressing a question that is different from the kind of question that it's in our remit to answer. The Spice report, as I understand it, is looking at the issue of what would the Scottish income tax position be if income tax had not been devolved versus the current situation where income tax has, a large part of income tax has been devolved and is set by the Scottish Government. And that's a kind of, it's a kind of hypothetical question about what, about how the devolution of income tax has changed the system. Our job essentially is not to make judgments about the devolved system of income tax versus other hypothetical alternatives, but to look at how the devolved system of income tax is working. So we make income tax forecasts, we forecast the effects of Scottish Government policy changes, notably the introduction of the new tax bans 2 or 3 years ago. So we're focusing on a slightly different set of issues. We're not, we don't get in the business of making judgments about how, you know, whether it's better to have devolved income tax or not to have devolved income tax, or what the effects are there going to be.
I feel I appreciate that, but I'm just wondering whether you produce for the Scottish Government, forecasts of what specific tax levels would mean in terms of the block grant adjustment potentially, so that the Scottish Government has a clearer focus and view of what a specific tax policy might result in.
Oh yes, when there is a change in tax policy, as there has been in a number of years, we forecast what these effects would be, and we also have forecasts of what the block grant adjustment is. So in that specific context of, you know, in a particular year when we have a Scottish Government proposal, we have our forecast of income tax revenue, including the effects of this year's policy change, and that's compared with the block grant adjustment to give the net effect on the Scottish Government, the Scottish Government's budget.
Thank you. That's very clear. Now, in your report, you talk about house prices, and you talk about house price stability being established in the current financial year, and you then say that prices will grow in subsequent years. I'm just wondering what the kind of how you've come to that conclusion. It seems to me that house prices appear to be rising quite significantly at this present time.
Well, they've been rising for a while, and I think the average house price is now a little bit over 200,000. Uh-huh. And we expect that, you know, this will rise to some extent over time. Is there a specific, John, do you have a...
I think the graph of or the forecast, you're right, there's a sort of there's been an upward movement in prices over the last year, and as Susan said, we've breached the average price of £200,000 now. This financial year, we're expecting that to sort of remain reasonably steady over the year as a whole. Obviously, we're only part of the way through the year. And in the subsequent years of the forecast, because of the growth in income, in nominal income within Scotland, we're expecting that those prices to sort of continue to rise. So there's almost like there's a sort of a gentle point of inflection during this course of this financial year, and obviously we've seen some data so far, and we're sort of expecting that for the rest of the year, sort of prices do remain stable.
Okay, thank you. I've actually got pages of questions here, but I'm going to let the committee in after the next one. And it's just basically about just a different topic again, and it's about international supply pressures. You know, you say in your forecast that we assume there are no future waves of rapidly rising hospital deaths and hospitalisations, but then you have ongoing international supply pressures which combined with domestic recruitment challenges present risks to your forecast. And of course, that's not just the impact of COVID, but Brexit also. So I'm just wondering how you're able to quantify the risks in terms of these supply pressures, because we've heard significant rises in raw material prices, for example, which can obviously impact on the Scottish Government's capital programme going forward, our ability to deliver it.
Yes, so those two pressures certainly exist, and just for clarity, the supply pressures are not simply in a direct relation to Brexit, because they come from countries all around the world. Uh-huh. You've been mentioning previously that China is on a huge kind of building and construction plan just now, and they're using a lot of their supplies rather than exporting them. So the supply pressures come from a lot of places. How we quantify these? Actually, John, do you have the detail of that?
What we've done in essence is we've thought about the mechanism by which these supply constraints are likely to impact upon the Scottish economy, and that's taken into account in our forecast in two ways. We've built that into our judgment on output. So we've thought through the potential impact on production of supply constraints this year primarily, and you see that reflected in the path of output. So output is, although it's rising rapidly this year, it doesn't bounce back as quickly as perhaps it could have been in absence of supply constraints. The other thing that we've done is we've looked at inflation, and we, in common with the Bank of England's latest monetary policy report, we're judging that inflation will peak at 4% by the end of this year. So we're seeing a price effect, and that's also built into our forecast. So they're the two mechanisms by which we've attempted to quantify those supply constraints.
If I could, the quote you read out also mentioned a bit of a blockage around job recruitment, and it's a slightly odd situation. I expect this will change over the coming months. So there seem to be lots of jobs as businesses begin to gear up and hiring, and yet there are lots of stories about the inability, for instance, to hire lorry drivers and therefore to get things delivered. So there's just something funny happening in that part of the labour market. The UK-wide furlough scheme, as it's called, is coming to an end at the end of September, and there is some speculation that people will have stayed on that, and then we'll see whether their employer is still a viable business or not, and at that point they may decide to look for another job, have to look for another job, but there's a bit of stasis right now, possibly until that cliff edge. We don't know, but that's partly speculation we've had.
Yeah, I think we've got skills and geographic mismatches in terms of the labour market quite significantly. Yeah. Liz,
thank you, convener, and good morning. Notwithstanding the better news that you published last week, namely that you felt that the scarring of the economy wasn't quite as bad as had been originally anticipated, you also mentioned that you felt there were significant risks ahead. And you flagged up that that was partly to do with the fact that it's difficult to predict consumer behaviour in the future and business behaviour. And that all ties down with the fact that, you know, there are very significant pressures on the budget because public spending is rising, public sector debt is rising, tax receipts are likely to come down because some businesses are failing. Would you be able to say to the committee, without hinting about government policy, because that's not your job, would you be able to say where you see the most significant risks ahead in terms of what the economy's shape is going to be?
Gosh, well, I've turned to all my colleagues to come in on that. But when we look at the economy forecast and we talk about risks, we've really only called out downside risks. We haven't called out any upside risks. And the downside risks really draw from the economic impacts of unknown, possible changes in health policy that then impact on economic activity. But we really do expect, because we've already seen those households which have managed to save starting to spend again. There's also been a lot of house improvement and activity around households as well, and in fact a shortage of a lot of the trades which serve this are really have a full order book, and it's hard to get that through. So that will continue activity. But Alistair, do you want to come in specifically on this?
Well, there are a couple of downside risks worth mentioning. One which we give significant attention to in the report is the downside risk that the future of COVID may be problematic. There might be vaccine escape, for example. So although our forecast is based on the assumption that we're not going to have another period of significant economic restrictions related to COVID, none of us can discount the risk that might turn out to be too optimistic, and we can all think of what the implications of that would be. On the economic side, as Susan said, our outlook at the moment is considerably more optimistic than it was in January. And that's based not just on the fact that the pandemic itself has the situation with the pandemic has eased with the rollout of the vaccination program. It's also that the bounce back of the economy as restrictions were removed has been faster and healthier than we and pretty much everyone else had expected. So it's possible to take the view, for example, if you're thinking about economic scarring, to contrast our situation now with the situation in the 1980s and 1990s when economies were responding to the decline of heavy industry, and the decline of heavy industry, coal mining and so on, left a lot of scarring in the economy, which lasted for a long time. People lost their jobs who never came back into employment. Communities lost economic opportunities and new economic opportunities didn't come back. At the moment, our view and the view of many others is that COVID doesn't look as if it's going to be like that. The bounce back is going to be reasonably healthy. There will young people will have difficult labour market experiences for a year or two, but we can hope that that won't last too long. But with all of these things, we have to be realistic and recognise that we may be making an over-optimistic judgment there, and that it will turn out that the long-term damage to the economy is actually greater than we're currently forecasting. So that's one other significant risk that I think we need to think about.
Just on a second point, which has been a lot of interesting articles and debate recently about the playoff between inflation and economic growth, which followed one of the interesting comments that the governor of the Bank of England made a couple of weeks ago. And I'm just interested, do you have, within your overview of the Scottish economy, areas where you think there is good potential for economic growth relatively quickly? And secondly, what areas do you feel, in terms of tax receipts, tax revenue coming in, would be helpful in terms of the Scottish economy and Scottish budget?
That's a big question. Mm-hmm. Francis, do you have any thoughts here?
Yes, I mean, I think you'll see in our report, we've looked a bit at the structural breakdown, and clearly, you know, one of the important things about this, the economic effects of COVID has been it's hit certain sectors much harder than others. So in a sense, many sectors have pretty much, you know, affected while others have taken a very significant hit. And we're clearly expecting those who took, we're hoping and expecting that those who took a significant hit will be part of the bounce back. And therefore, that will be an important part of where the economic growth and the tax growth comes from. But I would say, you know, putting on from what Alistair was saying, you know, one of the things that will happen or we expect to happen as a result of COVID is a bunch of structural changes in the economy will be accelerated. I mean, one of them is the fact that I'm sitting not with you in a room, but we've all got screens now. That will change the structure of the economy, and that will change where growth comes from in the future. And in a sense, the slightly more optimistic view of scarring is partly because research generally shows that some of those structural changes will be beneficial rather in the longer term. But clearly, at a point of structural change, it is fair to say that the forecasts and trying to work out which sectors will benefit and which will lose is actually very difficult, because structural change is very difficult to predict.
Could I just do a closing sentence following Francis's comments, which is that it isn't so much sectors as were, but maybe sectors as will be. Mm-hmm. So if you look at agriculture, which is a big part of Scottish economic activity, to the extent that the agriculture sector reinvents itself to some extent in anticipation of changes in eating habits and diet because of net zero sensitivities, sectors will change for what is happening in society more widely. So a little bit hard to pinpoint which ones will change and change quickly.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Daniel, to be followed by Douglas.
Thank you. So I'd quite like to follow on from some of the topics that have already been touched on. And by and large, I've got sort of a question about some of the short-term elements that we've been discussing and some of the longer terms that you've just been touching on with Liz. So in the shorter term, your forecast here has us returning to pre-COVID levels in quarter two. I just wonder how safe that forecast is for the very reasons that you set out, given that furlough is coming to an end. And also, if you look at some of the things that have been happening over recent months, we have the phenomenon of unexpected savers who are spending money on things that they wouldn't have otherwise. And we see that, I just saw a report yesterday showing that used car prices are up by 15%. You just highlighted on home improvements. Strikes me that those are not sustainable spending patterns, that those can't really be sustained really certainly into the medium or long term. So if that is true, is it safe to essentially straight line our economic performance from quarter two of this year, as your forecast would appear to do on the basis of your report? Or could we at least, if not expect, have a sense that there is a risk that we may have more of an oscillation in terms of our recovery, or that there may be some sort of headwinds that are accounted for from some of these effects?
So absolutely, there are headwinds. There will always be some headwinds. But one of the factors that encouraged us to bring that timeline earlier is the fact that in the second lockdown in January, we found that businesses overall and in general had figured out how to operate during a lockdown, during the funny time that we had for all of the last, close to a year and a half. And because of that, they were back. They had worked out how to, sell online. They, all of those services had improved. And therefore, we saw the economy coming back up to speed sooner. It's really sooner than we had thought previously, because the economic activity was a little bit stronger. So that was one of the factors behind our thinking. But again, Francis, maybe I'll turn to you, because you've got a lot of thoughts here.
Just quick first on the furlough scheme. And you're right, and we highlight that in the report, that clearly one of the tricky moments for the economy will be when furlough ends. But we are slightly encouraged the fact that there is significantly fewer people on furlough than there were even a few months ago, and therefore that makes us slightly more confident that we can negotiate that particular tricky moment slightly better. But I think you're right that we're going to have a period where spending patterns are going to flip around. Those excess savings are understandably going on mainly on sort of durable long-term goods, in the sense that that's a way of investing from your excess savings. But what we're expecting is that will be replaced more by the standard consumption patterns that you see as the economy recovers. So you will see those sectors like hospitality and recreation, all those ones stepping up to take over what's currently being dominated by durable consumption at the moment. I think your question raises a good point, which is those transitions from in consumption and in the economy, each one of those transitions is necessarily uncertain, and therefore there is definite risks as the economy sort of comes back on an even keel again.
Thank you. I mean, just to follow up on that point, I just wonder if I could just challenge the point you set out there about business having figured out how to operate through COVID. And certainly the businesses that I speak to, they've managed to get through COVID, but even though they may be trading, that their trading is significantly down from where it would be, 60 to 80% is for a lot of consumer-facing businesses is not usual. That's not sustainable for them. Furthermore, most of those businesses have got through to that point by accumulating quite significant sums of debt, whether that's through the government schemes or deferred rent with landlords or other arrangements they have made. Into even businesses report to me that small businesses owners having cashed in their pensions, and I'm told that a lot. So it strikes me that those businesses are now operating with a very different set of circumstances now compared to pre-COVID, And that too must imply a degree of fiscal headwind when you start looking at these figures, or certainly the overall economic performance of the country.
Yes, and your point is absolutely correct. I wasn't implying that it's been a good, you know, it's a good road for all businesses. It's just that compared to our expectations earlier, businesses had actually rallied overall, and not every single one, but on average, functioned somewhat better. The other factors that we looked at in earlier this year is the fact that education, schools opened up a little sooner, so we had more economic activity, more output related to that fact, and also the vaccination program, which had barely started at our January forecast, rolled out with a speed and a success that I'm not sure many people anticipated, and that added to output on the health side. So what helped us change our view about the economic activity and the speed of recovery was simply that things happened, but happened a little sooner than we expected.
Thank you. And if I could just ask one final question around the longer term impact of all of this. I mean, I totally accept that right now it's very difficult to predict what the long-term structural changes in the economy. I mean, I quite agree that they are certainly going to be there. I just wonder whether actually some of them, if not kind of able to safely predict, are certainly kind of a good bet in terms of, well, I say good bet, but it's very likely that there will be structural changes. So again, think about the consumer-facing economy, especially retail, and you know, declaring an interest as a former retailer. Those patterns of spend have permanently changed. I don't think there's anybody in the retail industry that thinks otherwise. So I just wonder, you know, to what degree you are starting to look at or identify those changes so that you can embed them in your forecasting as soon as possible and anticipate them, because some of them, as I say, are very likely to. And likewise, just in terms of that, those changing patterns of work, you know, having a screen and being able to work over Zoom is all well and good if you are somebody that deals with things that are suitable for that. If you're a retail worker or a delivery driver, I think doing those things by Zoom are somewhat more difficult. So again, you know, not just sectorally, but actually types of employment, the recovery might well look very, very different depending on where you are and what industry you work in. And are you starting to try to identify that and embed that within your forecasting?
So just a very quick comment about delivery, you know, because an awful lot of deliveries that we all receive now that we didn't receive before at home. But what will probably come is a rethink of how deliveries are actually done. So small, lots of hubs where different organizations can have an exchange from large-scale lorry containers to lots of last mile. The whole thing about the last mile delivery, there's a lot of work going on, but it's still to develop. So things will change as well. We just need to remind ourselves it won't just go back to being the way it was before. Alistair, do you have any views in this space?
No, I'm afraid not.
No,
Susan,
okay.
I don't have any further wisdom to add.
John, anything?
I suppose the only thing I would add is, as well as looking at these sort of very sectoral industry-based factors that you've been talking about, we're preparing our forecast by looking at very, very high-level sort of output series as well. And to some extent within that, you get a sort of cancellation out of the sort of effects that you're talking about. So the sort of the sectors with really strong growth, you know, will to some extent be mitigated by the sectors with slower growth. So you might see some greater stability at that aggregate level than you would if you start looking at the sort of the detail underneath it.
Okay, thank you. Douglas, followed by John.
Thank you,
convener. Come on, Matthew.
Just following on from what Daniel was talking about there.
I'm thinking more of the high street as well and non-domestic rates. Now, from your forecast from 2022-23 to 2026-27, non-domestic rates is due to go up by 17%. And I'm just trying to think how realistic that will be when we think of, you know, how much the high street would have changed through this pandemic. And, you know, are we also looking at how different businesses are going to be paying NDR going forward, or is that not part of your forecast?
Francis, I see you nodding. So.
I think Francis? It's over to you, Francis.
Sorry, you all cut out for a couple of seconds there, so I'm sorry about that. So I think on NDR, the lot of the bounce back you mentioned is really just the end of relief, so in a sense that's somewhat baked in. But I think you're right about the longer term issues about commercial property, and that's something that we have looked at very carefully, and we've really tried to use contacts with the industry, contacts with the trade bodies, to really try and get a feel as to whether use of commercial property change will have a big impact on the nature of that tax revenue. So I think you're right to highlight that as one of the areas that is, you know, as we've already mentioned, you know, where, you know, that's where the structural change we anticipate there could be something going on that we really need to keep an eye on. But at the moment, we don't have any strong indications of change, of structural change in use of commercial property. But that is clearly a thing we've got a very close eye on, because that's a very much a pinch point for the structural change that we all anticipate.
And there's a lot of information that still needs to come out in the NDR space. There were a large number of appeals called material change of circumstance appeals. And assessors, everything slowed down in terms of the assessors coming to conclusions as well. And so we have to wait and see how the numbers actually play out here. So there are some question marks, if not downside risks.
Okay. If I can continue, Convener, I was looking at income tax revenue as well. From 2020 to 21, it's moving from just under 12 billion to 17.3 billion in 26-27, but at the same time, the 16 to 64 year old workforce is decreasing by, I think it was 60,000. So I'm just trying to work out how there could be such a big increase when the workforce is falling.
Alistair.
Well, that's primarily driven by the economic growth in the forecast. Partly, as we have already discussed, there's an element of inflation in that, and partly it's real growth. So yes, the Scottish workforce is expected to decline numbers, but the overall Scottish economy is nevertheless growing, and income tax grows with a somewhat accelerated effect as the economy grows. Mm-hmm.
But also in the report, the nominal earnings is due to rise. I think it's 2.1% and 2.5%, which is not really matching the increase in income tax. So I'm just trying to think whether I'm missing something here on the amount of income. Do you assume that bands are going to change? People are going to be paying more tax per person, or how is it?
Well, one factor is income tax is paid. Most income tax is paid by a relatively small minority of taxpayers, the better off taxpayers. So there isn't a straightforward one-to-one relationship between income and income tax. As I said, as the economy grows, one effect is people who weren't paying tax are drawn into paying income tax, people are drawn into income tax at higher rates. And that has this kind of has an accelerating effect on tax revenue. So the relationship between tax revenue and income that is in our forecast is a perfectly normal kind of relationship that would be expected. We're not doing any fancy magical maths here to get these effects.
So is there any... Sorry, but I can continue. Can we now,
of course, sir.
Is there assumptions made in the tax bands? Do you assume that they're staying as they are, or just going up in line with inflation? Or how would they...
I think embedded in when you first asked the question was whether we were expecting a change of tax bands or something of that sort. So we work with what the policy is today. So we don't think the government may change tax bands. So the answer to that is no. We're not playing with scenarios of that sort. We work with what we have today.
We do make assumptions about indexation of bans or not indexation of bans. So, for example, the UK government has announced that the personal allowance will be frozen for the next few years, and we build that into the forecast. So we use policy announcements in that sort of way.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Joined to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks very much, Convener. Yes, I mean, inflation's been mentioned a few times already, so I don't want to spend a lot of time on that, but as I understand it, you've followed the Bank of England rather than the OBR, mainly because their forecasts are more recent. I think my interest is, if we're at 4% just now, how confident are we that it's going to fall to 2.5%? Because it seems to me that some of the pressures, like shortage of labour, might continue longer term, and would that therefore mean that inflation continues higher a longer term? I suppose, being of a slightly older generation, you know, I do remember inflation being at 15%, so 4% seems reasonably low to me, but by recent years it's relatively high. So any thoughts around that?
I think Francis has some thoughts.
I think you are entirely correct that it is, you know, it's a risk, and that we very much agree with Bank of England's assessment that his, you know, current information is it's a short-term issue, but you know, short-term issues do have becoming long-term ones, and particularly clearly if as you point out, if the constraints are in the labour market, that's where you will start to see, you know, longer-term pressures on inflation. I think currently a lot of the pressures are in the supply chain, which we do think will just sort of, you know, watch out over the coming period. But I think you're right to highlight that as a risk. And in a sense, I suppose, you know, the ultimate bulwark against going back up to 15% again is actually the Bank of England itself. If the Bank of England itself begins to perceive that risk of inflation, it will react. So obviously it has not reacted to this rather temporary increase, but it will react more the more it thinks is a longer term increase.
Okay, thanks for that. I mean, another issue is kind of more widely the whole question of population. Now, our birth rate has been low in recent years, but that's been made up for by immigration on the whole, and there seems to be a bit of a reduction in immigration at the moment. So can I ask what your assumptions are about population and how big an impact? I mean, should we worry about that? My simple thinking is if the population's growing, the economy will probably grow. If the population's falling, it's very difficult to make the economy grow, and especially in relation to the rest of the UK. If their population's growing and ours isn't, where do we go from there?
So it's a very important space to think about. First of all, the fertility rate in Scotland has been dropping, but it's not just in Scotland. I mean, this is happening in countries all around the world, so it is a general phenomenon. But our fertility rate has been dropping, and if you asked about comparison to the rest of the UK, population growth there is a little faster than ours, and we expect that to continue to be faster. The other factor in the population is that what we have in Scotland is the sort of growth of the older population, many of whom are no longer active in the labour market. They're no longer working. So you have fewer children coming in. Therefore, we expect fewer people joining the labour market in due course, and then more people in that older age group who may not be actively working but may actually be costing. So we look at both sides. So when we talked about ADP as a benefit, there will be more people, possibly for longer, who attract that benefit. So it's a combination of things balancing each other. And it matters.
Right. I mean, is it? So, I mean, presumably the birth rate's not going to change very rapidly, but the immigration side could change. I mean, there's demand from industry that immigration should be allowed for specific sectors, and yeah. I think at the moment the UK government said they won't do that. So, how important is that? I mean, if there was a big suddenly immigration was allowed, would that make a big difference to the forecasts?
So one can only speculate, except to say that if immigration was allowed, what would matter most is that the immigrants were people of working age and came into the economy and started creating more activity.
Okay, thanks. I was interested in your report. It's on page 33 of mine. I'm not sure if that's everyone's page 33, but anyway, it's called Box 3.1 Uncertainty Indicators. And as I understand it, that's a new measure that you're trying to do, and I was quite fascinated by it. So I just wondered if somebody could explain it to me and what it tells us.
So I'm very excited about this because we've created this, and I think it's very good. This is about political uncertainty. It's about the impact of what is being thought about and discussed and debated out there in public, and if that creates greater uncertainty, that may affect the decisions that people make economically, the behaviors that they show economically. So the Scottish Uncertainty Index has been created, and it's gone back for any number of years to look back to see what it reflected in terms of events in society, and then we'll continue to monitor this. It picks up, I won't go into the detail of what it picks up, but John, do you want to say anything more about it?
Yeah, it's what we've done here really is take a methodology which other people are using, including the Bank of England, to look at sort of policy uncertainty in a political sense. And it's based on online searches of newspaper articles. We select a number of key words, and then basically the index picks up how many times these words occur in newspaper articles. So in a sense, it's very, very simple. It takes a bit of time to do. Fortunately, it's all automated, so that makes life easier. What I thought was fascinating about this was, if you look at that box, you can actually see the first independence referendum features in that index. The EU referendum features in that index. And the impact in Scotland is greater than in the UK as a whole. And also the sort of the Brexit negotiations and when independence was coming back into the news, 2019-20, again, you can see that. So I think I think we're sort of interested in this. We need to do a lot more work on this and sort of calibrate it to sort of what's happening in the economy. But we thought it was a good starting point.
I mean, how objective is it? I mean, we don't all have faith in newspapers and how...
No, but I think it's not necessarily that what the newspapers are reporting is accurate. It may be accurate, it may not be, and depending on your faith in newspapers and journalists. But what does matter in a sense is what people are talking about. So it's capturing that sense that this is in the news.
Yes.
So I think that, and because other people have done it, people have done it across the world, and the Bank of England is doing it for the UK and has done it for some time, we have some sort of faith in the methodology for that reason.
Okay. And what would the impact be on actual people's behaviour? I mean, if there's more uncertainty, does that mean people maybe save more, for example?
That could...
You could speculate almost anything, but yes, people could hold back on big spending decisions. They could consider, where they live. They could consider, is it time to change jobs and take a risk or not? There are lots of ways this could impact on their decisions, but those decisions will then have an economic impact.
So we'll keep an eye on that going forward.
Yeah, I think it's important to sort of say, we're at the stage of developing the index. We haven't done that sort of second step that Susan's talking about, of actually looking at how it impacts upon the economy.
That's great, thanks. And the final area I just wanted to ask you, which is an area that's come up before, is how you are at the moment with getting the data that you need and the quality of the data, either from Scottish sources or UK, HMRC, all of these kind of areas.
Thank you very much for asking that. You've been on this committee for a while and have known our journey along that road much better than ever before. We've developed some good relationships with some of the major UK agencies who provide us data. It takes time for them sometimes to change reports. Sometimes the timeliness makes a difference to us. As you know, we make every effort possible to use publicly available data, and that's part of our approach towards transparency, that we can publish, you know, the sources of the data and what those data are. But we're in a much better space. That doesn't mean that there aren't even improvements that could be made, and every year we publish, because we were asked by a different parliamentary committee some years ago, we publish a report on a statement of our data needs, and we identify what next would be helpful to us, but it's improved. Sean?
And could I just add to that, that actually the position is, as Susan says, is stable this year, and, you know, for the past 3 years, I think we produced the statement of data need on recommendation from the previous session's Economy and Fair Work Committee. But this year, we've decided to move that publication to sort of every 2 years, because you know, there's nothing at the moment really pressing in our data needs. So we'll do that. We haven't done it this year. We'll do it next year.
Okay, thanks so much. Thanks, Camino.
Thank you. Michelle.
Thank you. I suppose I've been listening to the relative contributions with great interest, and the themes that keep reoccurring is around uncertainty and complexity. And I can appreciate the very difficult job you have to do to reconcile what's actually happened against the forecast of what might happen. So I'm interested in exploring that a bit further. We've touched on some of the rationale you use for your analysis when questions have been asked. I'm personally interested in understanding the rationale for some of your analysis in your report, if you like. So, for example, climate change, we know, is going to affect us. We know net zero targets are being talked about a great deal. My question then is, in terms of your analysis, how are you reflecting issues such as this, and can you see a development of your report where you're reflecting more on your analysis?
That's interesting. I'm looking at any of my colleagues. Francis, you want to come in there?
I think we want to develop in the area of looking at these longer term risks. You're right, climate change is a current risk as well as a longer term risk, but there are issues. In fact, we've been raising them already in this meeting about, you know, long-term population changes in these areas, which I think, you know, we could usefully look at. And they are not they're not written about very much in the current report, because the current report has a very specific focus, which is on, you know, the short-term forecast and the budget implications of that. So I think you raise an important question.
Alistair, do you want to?
No, I don't have anything.
John,
I've got another one.
I should hope so.
I think the only thing I would add is what I said to Mr. Johnson slightly earlier, that a lot of this stuff around net zero and the sort of commitments and the changes, for example, to energy efficiency and the production of energy, are these sort of things which go underneath in the sort of the balances and changes there. So on the top level aggregate we've forecast for 5 years, you probably wouldn't see an immediate impact, but there's really important stuff going down underneath which we need to keep an eye on. And as Francis says, if you know, thinking about sort of 20 years forward is very different from thinking about 5 years forward.
And in that respect, I was equally excited about Box 31 starting to get into that sort of thing. Following on, perhaps in a sort of similar theme around GDP per capita, we know there's endless debates about how effective that is as a measure, but we know it's internationally understood and you're using it, and quite rightly so. However, I'm wondering what, if any, thinking you've given to other measures in addition to GDP per capita because of its known and understood crudity, particularly as we start to move into somewhat amorphous, I know at the moment, but a so-called well-being economy. So I just wondered what thoughts or consideration you'd had to that.
That's a very good question. And again, I see Francis nodding, so let me turn to you.
Okay, well, yes, I think I was nodding in the sense that I agree you. This is an important area, and I do agree with the concept that GDP is a somewhat narrow measure. But I mean, sadly, from our point of view, because we have a very, you know, significant focus on the budget and on money, it's actually the measure that matters to us for that particular job of looking at the budget. So I don't think it's really in our world to look at those measures, but I do agree with you that those measures are valuable and important, and you know, we would encourage others to think about it. But if your role is ours, like ours, is looking in the sense of the monetary implications, the budget implications, then you know, GDP is actually pretty much the best measure for our job.
Thank you. The best worst, I think most people agree. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. We still have some time, so I'm going to let colleagues come back in again. But first of all, I'll ask some more questions. The first one is really a follow-up to John's question about the uncertainty index, and it's to ask whether you feel that the cooperation agreement between the Greens and the Scottish Government, where that would sit on the uncertainty index. Does it make the ability of the Scottish Fiscal Commission, the ability to forecast, more or less certain?
We don't forecast political outcomes.
No, but there's financial detail in there. For example, £500 million for the North East, in addition to, of 10,000 more affordable homes, etc., etc. So there are kind of components, specific components within that deal. So,
John,
our forecasting of government expenditure is limited, in essence, to Social Security. Now, there are some content of the agreement between the Greens and SNP there, for example, the doubling of Scottish Child Payment. So, in a sense, the direct impact for us is really around expenditure commitments which within our remit, so Social Security spending. And, of course, the other thing which is interesting in that sense is how it will change the budget process. We've been used to operating in a world in which the budget process is sort of two bites at the cherry, the initial budget, and then the sort of negotiations about how to get it through Parliament. Now, obviously, that will go away, and it will make how we approach our forecasting and that sequencing different.
So in that regard, there will be a reduction in uncertainty?
Yes, it will be upfront and certainty, one-off rather than two-off.
Thank you. Now, this morning, members of the committee received a letter from the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, actually, which was quite detailed, and no doubt colleagues will be asking about that in the next session. But one of the things she said in this letter is, and I quote, "There is logic for publishing the medium-term financial strategy alongside the Scottish budget and thereby basing it on the updated SFC and OBR forecasts. Publishing it before the OBR October forecasts would mean having used OBR forecasts from March, the effect of which would be to give a misleading sense of the fiscal outlook." Is that something that the Commission would agree with?
So the statement that using the relying on the OBR forecasts from March, because the OBR forecasts affect the BGAs, therefore affect our budget position, and those forecasts are out of date. The OBR are the first to say that, obviously. Mm-hmm. We expect October 27th for them to produce an up-to-date set of forecasts. So there's legitimacy in saying that those are out-of-date numbers, but beyond that,
It's slightly difficult because we haven't had sight of that letter from the Cabinet Secretary. Yeah. But I think when it comes to thinking about this year's MTFS, which I presume the letter is talking about, there are some timing considerations there about when the forecasts are in a sense, you know, as up-to-date as possible and when they coincide. But I think, in all honesty, to give you a considered reaction about that letter, it would be better to read the letter and get back to you. So if it's okay, we can certainly write to you and give you some sort of sense of what our views of that letter.
Yeah, I'm sure the clerks will let you have that. We only received it at 7 a.m. this morning, so it's sorry for kind of...
Fair enough. I think Alistair wanted to add something. Yeah.
As John said, I'm not going to respond to a letter that we haven't seen. Mm-hmm. There are uncertainties arising from the fact that the OBR forecasts are important to the Scottish Government's budget because they affect the block grant adjustments. And the current OBR forecasts are somewhat out of date, and we will have more up-to-date forecasts in October, I think it is. Now, we have highlighted some areas in our report where that is significant. So we clearly indicated that the current forecast of the net position on income tax should be looked at with great caution, because while we have as much faith in our income tax forecast as we always do, the the income tax BGA is based on an out-of-date forecast, so the net position shouldn't attach too much weight. But there are other important elements in the budget, and the Social Security budget, in particular the adult disability payment, is a big element in the budget, where uncertainty about OBR forecasts is not really a factor for postponing serious consideration of the issue.
Yes, I mean, you've talked about Social Security a couple of times and no one in the committee has yet asked about it, but the prediction is of a £1.5 billion increase in Social Security spend, you know, of which the adult disability payment will be a major component over the next 5 years, that, according to your figures. That is, given the fact it's been mentioned a couple of times, does that cause concern to the Fiscal Commission, or is it just something you just want to ensure that we don't omit in our deliberations?
So it's not our job to be concerned about policy. I say that somewhat tongue-in-cheek. What we're trying to call out is that if there's a difference between the funding available to the Scottish Government in the case of Social Security benefits, some of it comes from DWP, and because of the government's policy to make these benefits more widely available and easier to access to more people, there will be greater spend here. The Scottish Government is required to have a balanced budget, as you know, and that means that if it spends more in one place, it needs to match that in some way, and matching that would be from within Scotland, so either by raising taxes within Scotland or by not spending on some other program in order to fund this program. The thing about Social Security, and particularly the ADP, is that it's a large number and it's somewhat open-ended, because once people qualify, they don't often come off it, and you don't know how long and for how many years they'll be receiving the benefit. It's not a one-off benefit at a certain point in time, which is easier to predict. So we raise it simply to bring out that perhaps need for thoughtfulness in terms of looking at the budget overall.
Yes, and the child payment could be £163 million a year. I think in your opening statement and in your report you said about half a billion extra would have to be found by 2026-7, is that correct, from resource budget?
Yes, and there's still a tiny number of Social Security payments where we don't have the clear policy yet on the Scottish side, so we haven't costed them, but something, and that's a big sum of money, half a billion pounds, so it just has to be thought about and anticipated.
Okay, Liz wants to come in, and then Daniel, and then I'll come back in again with another question.
Thank you, Convener. Obviously, one of the dates that's on the horizon in the not-too-distant future is the outturn report for the fiscal framework, which I think the government's identifying as the 1st of October. And that will lead on to the revision of the fiscal framework and the agreement, etc. Are there things that you would like to see within the fiscal framework parameters that would make forecasting a bit easier?
So a good question. It is not our job. So there is to be a review, and always has been in the plans, of the fiscal forecast in this time period, this fiscal year. Not our job to shape or drive that. It's really between the governments, between the Scottish Government and the UK
sure,
government.
But are there things you'd like to see in terms of helping perhaps to reduce uncertainty and plan ahead in terms of forecasting?
So let me just say, if we're consulted, we will obviously, you know, respond to that. But one of the things that we have raised before, and I thought of saying it just a minute ago, is something around a greater certainty, a greater expectation, planning perhaps around the timetabling of the MTFS, of the budget, of when these activities will happen. We require so many weeks to produce our budgets. To the extent that we know ahead of time when these are coming, that would be really useful to us, and we've been very open about that. John, other things? Yeah.
I think you were asking specifically about the fiscal outturn report, and we've been working with the government for many years on that, and I think it's fair to say that over the years we think the quality of that report and the information in it and the transparency has increased enormously. So. Without saying it's absolutely perfect, but I think we're pretty happy about the way that's been going and the improvements in that report over the years.
Would it be correct to say that with all the additional forecasting that now goes on and the improvement in the use of that data, do you feel as statisticians who are predicting on the future in terms of making use of that data, do you think that economic forecasting is getting more accurate?
Just look at the last block grant adjustment. 34 million.
It's complicated. So, well, Alistair, yes or no?
It is the case that over the life of the Fiscal Commission, the availability of data, as Susan has said, has improved, and that has somewhat reduced the uncertainties that we face. But forecasting is inherently a business of dealing with uncertainties, and we're not looking for magic solutions that are going to make our job easier. In a sense, that's not the issue about fiscal uncertainty is not about making our job easier. It's about making the question of as John said, it's not for John and Susan said, it's not for us to propose what changes in the fiscal framework should take place. But the central question for the fiscal framework is whether there are uncertainties facing the Scottish Government in the current system that could be different in a different system.
But put it another way, if there are improvements in the data that have happened over a period of time, that would imply that your job has become slightly easier,
yes.
Maybe not yes. Perfect by any means, but slightly easier. And therefore that begs the question whether you feel that because it's slightly easier that what you are producing for government is more accurate, even though it's got complexities, it's more accurate than it used to be. Would that be fair?
I'll be optimistic and say yes, that's fair.
Let me just say that accuracy is a word that makes me take a deep breath because forecasts are never really accurate. But what we have done over the time we've been in existence with the better data and also just more sophistication is create our own models and improve our own models for the forecasts. And I think we're doing a much better job now. So we have our own economy forecast we created ourselves. Initially, we didn't use that, and this is better. We're using different data sources. We understand the impact of RTI data as opposed to the data we used to use from HMRC. So all of those are improvements, but more accurate makes me hesitate briefly.
Well, we'll take it as an accurate answer anyway.
Okay, Dan?
Thank you. I just wanted to return to the issue that the convener raised regarding the block grant and income tax revenues and the Spice paper. And in particular, and I recognise what you were saying, that you don't want to get into the realms of hypotheticals of previous regimes, but the fundamentals here, as I understand it, set out in the paper, are that the current fiscal framework, in a sense, relies on kind of income tax growth. And the fundamental point that this would seem to point to is that income tax receipts per capita in Scotland have grown more slowly than the rest of the UK. Now, is that a conclusion that is supported by the data that you have? If so, what are the reasons behind it? And critically, and the reason I'm asking the question is that I think we're all very mindful that the fiscal framework is being renegotiated, and therefore the fundamentals of how that works and what it is that we benefit from, in terms of income tax growth being so critical in the current regime, as I understand it, is clearly very important as that is renegotiated. So I was just wondering if you could maybe elaborate on what insight you have in terms of income tax receipt growth per capita in Scotland versus the rest of the UK.
Well, the fundamentals of a devolved income tax system is that Scottish income tax receipts depend on the income generated in the Scottish economy, where in a non-devolved income tax system, Scottish income tax receipts depend on Scotland's share of UK income tax receipts. So that fundamental feature means that, yes, if the Scottish economy evolves in a way where the pattern of income is different from the UK, then devolved income tax receipts in Scotland will be different from what they would have been in a non-devolved system. That's just stating the basic facts. And what that highlights is that Scottish income tax receipts and therefore the Scottish budget depend on the performance of the Scottish economy, depend on the growth of Scottish productivity, because high productivity basically means a higher proportion of high-paying jobs, high income tax-paying jobs in the economy. There are no, there are nothing magic about that, but it does focus attention on important questions about the long-term growth of the Scottish economy, the growth of productivity, the demographic changes that Susan was talking about earlier, the proportion of the non-working elderly population to the working population. Those are the issues on which the future of the Scottish economy depends, as they do for any other economy. But devolution focuses attention on the Scottish economy specifically, even more than ever.
So and just to sort of take that next step, I absolutely understand those points, but I think that the key conclusion that's been drawn by this paper is that growth has been slower in Scotland than the rest of the UK. I mean, is that a conclusion that you would share, and do you have insight into that?
Well, I, as John said earlier, the John or Susan, I'm sorry, I can't remember. The Spice report is asking a question that is different from the kinds of questions that we ask. So we're not going to take a position on whether we line up with the Spice report, because it's different from, that's not our job. I think I better stop there. The Spice report is addressed to a very serious and important question. It's different from the questions to which we address, and therefore I'm not going to get into a detailed discussion of the way the analysis of the Spice report is.
But the fundamentals are, we want productivity to go up so people are paid more, so that they pay more tax. That's the fundamentals of what we're looking at in broad terms.
I wouldn't disagree with that.
Absolutely. He's just warming up for the Cabinet Secretary, don't
I? Yeah, exactly so.
One final question from me, and then we'll call the session to a halt, which is, in terms of the fiscal overview, the Scottish Fiscal Commission notes that the UK Government has not guaranteed any additional funding for COVID-19 for 21-22, and there are currently no arrangements for deferred funding. You said that given the Scottish Government's requirement to maintain a balanced budget, I quote, large changes to COVID-19 funding late in the financial year may create difficulties for the Scottish Government's management of its budget. So can you just talk us through one or two of these difficulties?
Yes, so last year there were several tranches of funding from the UK government which went to the nations, it was spread out, which related to COVID measures. And they came at different points in the year. But the numbers involved with that kind of funding are only firmed up towards the end of a fiscal year, so usually I think in February. That makes it very hard for a government that has to have a balanced budget and has to make spending decisions throughout the year and how to wisely spend money. So the Scottish government spoke to the UK government, and what came out of that, I think in early summer last year, was a guarantee that the number that had been put on the table at that point was a minimum and would not, you know, it wouldn't drop below. And then there were more tranches after that. There was one tranche that was announced, I believe, in March, weeks with the UK budget, weeks before the end of the fiscal year, and that would have been impossible for the Scottish budget to put into place and actually to spend. Scotland has a hard stop at the end of March to fund councils and to confirm income tax bans, so it doesn't have flex in time at that point. So the UK government, or Treasury specifically, agreed to let that money carry over to be used this year. So those were helpful forms of support to ensure that the money could be used properly and thoughtfully by this government, and I assume by the other nations. This year, there's about a little over four and a half billion of COVID support funding that's been put on the table, but there are no guarantees of that sort, and there's no promise about a carryover at this point in time. So that number, which may go up if things got worse or maybe stays the same, possibly would go down by the time the February supplemental estimates are agreed. And that's relatively late in the financial year. So that's why we pointed that out. There isn't quite the certainty around this extra funding.
And if it helps, I could say that last year, the late funding was $1.2 billion worth from the UK government. And you can only use up to $700 million in the reserve. So you can see that last year, even with the greater ability to use the reserve because of the Scotland economic-specific shock, you've got that sort of constraint of $700 million.
Okay. Well, thank you very much to our witnesses for that very interesting presentation and the questions that were answered this morning. We're now going to call a halt until 11 p.m. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
AM, sorry.
Nighttime sessions. Very innovative.
Sorry.
Okay, we now to move to our second session of the day, in which we'll hear from Kate Forbes, Cabinet Secretary of Finance and Economy, and Douglas McLaren, Deputy Director, Budget, Pay and Pensions of the Scottish Government. I'd like to welcome our witnesses to the meeting, not least because the Cabinet Secretary has just come straight from a local government committee and has had an exceptionally busy morning already. Members have received a paper providing background information for the session, but before I open up the session to questions of the committee, I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, convener. It's great to be with you this morning. I'm sorry not to be there in person. I'd hoped that this might be the first finance committee in person since the pandemic struck. I certainly want to continue to build on what I think is quite an open and collaborative approach with your predecessor finance committee in the last session. And I'm very grateful for the early engagement that my officials had with your Clarkin team. Just a few issues I wanted to raise at the outset, and I'm getting quite a bit of feedback, so hopefully you can all hear me okay. And the first thing is that I know the committee will want as much early clarity on the process and the timetable for next year's budget. I would very much like to build on the experience I've had over the last two budgets, contending with the implications and uncertainty around the timing of the UK government's fiscal event, and to move to early consideration with the committee and what those implications are. Because in light of the uncertainty of the UK government's budget, there are pros and cons of whether we go ahead of the UK government's budget or we wait until the UK government's budget. I think that debate has been informed by the SFC's forecast last Thursday, with the OBR now requested by the Chancellor to put its forecast at the end of October. So there are obviously a number of other areas that the committee will need to touch on. And so I only want to make one more point before handing back to the leader. Later today, we are pushing Scotland's first framework for tax, the consultation to enhance Scottish approach to taxation and setting out our programme of work for tax over this Parliament. And I very much look forward to the committee's views on that as well. And I'll stop there and just to make the point again that I'm getting quite a lot of feedback, so I do hope you can hear me and hope that I can hear you. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I think some of the members are having a wee bit of difficulty in hearing you clearly. I don't know if we can maybe see if there's a possibility of any technical adjustments. If not, we'll just have to soldier on. So if you can bear with me just a wee minute or two. Thank you. I've been advised that broadcasting are trying to improve communications, but also that we should plough on meantime. So I hope that you'll be able to hear me. I'll try and enunciate clearly and not be as west of Scotland as I normally am in asking these questions. You being a poshie and all that, you'll probably be able to translate what Daniel's saying much more clearly than myself. Okay. So first of all, the fiscal framework, I'm just wondering whether or not there's been any progress made in terms of the review of the fiscal framework, because I know there's been some real difficulty in terms of getting the UK government round the table in order to, and of course we're hoping to have this review by the end of the year.
Thank you for that. There has been progress in the sense that we continue to engage on an ongoing basis with the UK government. Obviously, the fiscal framework is due to be reviewed in 2022, and it will be preceded by an independent report that is presented to both governments by the end of this year. I think the committee would agree that the fiscal framework has been subjected to quite unprecedented stress testing, and we wouldn't have anticipated pressures on it when it was originally agreed in 2016. So it's my view, and this is where there is some disagreement, it's my view that the review should be quite broad in scope, and the report and the review should consider the operation of the framework, but also how it can be improved. And the arrangements for the review require joint agreement with the UK government. We haven't been able to achieve that agreement to date, but I will be discussing the next step with the Chief Secretary in the coming weeks. And my goal is to get agreement and to ensure that we meet that timetable. I would really welcome the support of the committee in continuing to make the case to the UK government for a broad-ranging review that is in line with the predecessor's report on the fiscal framework, and I hope that we can work together to achieve a meaningful review rather than just ticking the box of a review.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Now, obviously, politics moves very fast in Scotland, and we now have an agreement between the Scottish Government and the Green Party through the cooperation agreement, and ministers will indeed be appointed this afternoon, including a former member of this committee, Patrick Harvey. So I'm just wondering what work has been done looking at the implications of this in terms of the public finances as we go forward. So, for example, the number of affordable houses to be built to 2032 will increase from 100,000 to 110,000. But, of course, this is at a time of labour and skill shortages. £500 million will be invested in a just transition fund for the North East and Murray, and there's going to be a fair review to provide a realistic alternative to car use and increase investment in active travel and public transport. And of course, there's also the likelihood that the funding for this would impact on other Scottish Government policies and programmes. So I'm just wondering if you can take me through the process for as to how this will work in terms of taking the budget forward.
Yes, as you can imagine, in terms of the financial implications, I have been, for want of a better phrase, all over that to understand what the implications and the consequences might be. You talked about housing as one example. Now, we set out the budget for our original target of 100,000 homes as part of the capital spending review. And I think as a result of a number of different discussions, and obviously we'll have the programme for government next week as well, that's a really important consideration. We will be considering the capital requirement. But in terms of the core financial implications on the resource side and the capital side, those will be settled as part of the budget setting process. So we have come to an agreement. The responsibility now is for us to fund that part of the budget. But the second part to this is it's obviously a multi-year cooperation agreement, and that leads us into the resource spending review, because the resource spending review is where we had intended to both cost and plan for multi-year commitments. The cooperation agreement will now be factored into that resource spending review. And just as a little bit of history, although I'm sure you're all excited on this, we had hoped to do our spending review, our multi-year spending review, last autumn. We couldn't proceed with it then because the UK government's planned resource spending review last year didn't go ahead. We are hoping, certainly the hints are there, the intentions are there, that the UK government will do its comprehensive spending review this autumn, and that allows us then to push our own plans for the multi-year spending that we intend to do, which will include the cooperation agreement.
Okay, thank you very much for that. A number of members, myself included, raised issues with regard to tax and demography, etc. And one of the issues that is of concern, obviously, is the need to grow the Scottish economy relative to the UK economy. We have got real demographic challenges, and there's a productivity issue as well. So I'm wondering what steps are going to be taken on that. We recently, the Scottish Government pointed out that the UK has had the lowest economic growth of any Northwest European state over the last 12 years or so since the financial crash, but Scotland doesn't seem to have done particularly well in comparison to that, in that some years is reflected by the block grant adjustment. So what can we do to try and increase that productivity so that we can restore and improve some health of the public finances and indeed enhance them?
Well, there's a lot in that question. So if I try and take it in turn, my bottom line is that the primary way of increasing public revenue in order to fund our public services is through broadening and increasing the tax base. To do that, we need to maximise the number of people and the number of people in fair, well-paid, secure employment. So that's just the bottom line. And I'm sure the SFC were making that point in relation to the updated forecast. There's two primary ways of doing that. And one is, the first is my primary concern, which is an economic strategy over the next 10 years that deals with these structural challenges of productivity, of maximising the number of well-paid jobs. So we have, hopefully, heading for significantly lower unemployment than we perhaps feared, but at the same time, a lot of businesses are saying that they're struggling to recruit. Now, many of them have formerly relied on EU labour, but without the staff, those businesses can't go and develop. Without the staff, these individuals are not earning and therefore not paying income tax. So the two ways to ensure that our economic strategy for the next 10 years absolutely has a laser-like focus on the areas where we want to see growth and development and economic recovery. And the second thing is that we need people. So if we first focus on ensuring that as many people who are already resident in the country have the right skills for these jobs, we also need to ensure we have an attractive immigration policy. And that is what so many of these sectors are doing right now, that they just cannot recruit because of the previous reliance on EU labour, which is not materialising. So in terms of what I'm actually going to do, those would be my two answers. One is we need a long-term economic strategy that deals with these structural issues like productivity, and that's what I intend to do with the economic strategy that should be published in the next few months. And the second thing is immigration, of attracting a workforce to this country, to be able to fill these roles, to be able to allow these businesses to trade profitably, and to enable people to pay income tax.
I mean, I agree with the comments you've made. However, the UK and Scotland have the same immigration policies. So what can Scotland do to improve its position relative to the rest of the United Kingdom? Because in terms of block grant adjustment taxation, that's obviously a major consideration in terms of future budgetary considerations.
Well, if I could just take one short detour, because you talked about block grant adjustments. One of the areas that I think needs to be reviewed by the fiscal framework is this point around income tax and income tax methodology, because, and the SFC have detailed this as well in their own reports, but we are conscious that the methodologies applied when it comes to income tax for our tax base is probably not as helpful as it could be, in that we have a different tax base than the rest of the UK. So, for example, yes, we need to perhaps maximise the number of people paying, broaden the tax base at the upper ends because of the way that it's calculated. But at the moment, there is a question about the methodologies that are applied to the tax base in the way the block grant adjustment is calculated. But I shall leave that to one side. In terms of what else we need to do, clearly we are more exposed to the impact of oil and gas. So you'll have seen that in the SFC forecast that was published last week, where when there's a reduction in demand for oil and gas, that clearly has implications for individuals working in that area. And therefore, we are more exposed to the income tax implications of a drop in oil and gas. So my view is that we need to diversify, and that's the point of the economic strategy, is to focus on the opportunities with alternative emerging technologies, with the renewables, and with the transition, the just transition. We're seeing countries around the world, businesses in countries around the world, are grappling to get a competitive advantage in some of these new and emerging technologies. Well, I want to ensure that it's happening in Scotland, that the supply chains in Scotland that we're creating good jobs as a result of pioneering research and development. And that's one area I think that we can have a competitive advantage if we get it right. But none of this happens automatically without intentionally trying to ensure that we capture the opportunities here in Scotland.
Okay, thank you. And just one final question from me before I open questions out to the committee. The Scottish Fiscal Commission noted that the government hasn't guaranteed any additional funding for COVID-19 for 21-22, and there are currently no arrangements for deferred funding. And they've said that, and I quote, large changes in COVID-19 funding late in the financial year may create difficulties for the Scottish Government's management of its budget. Now, I asked that question of the SFC, but I'm just wondering if you can respond as to what kind of difficulties that could create for the Scottish budget going forward.
It's one of my greatest headaches, because last year we were deeply concerned that the UK Government could revise up or down the funding that we receive. So bear in mind, consequentials only emerge from money that's actually spent, not money that's announced. So last year, and I use last year as an important comparison, last year, when, for example, the UK government would announce X hundred million for the Scottish government to spend on business, we would be under pressure immediately to spend that. That money could then be changed, having already given that money over to business. So midway during the year, the UK government implemented a guarantee, which is to say that the money wouldn't be revised down. Unfortunately, that guarantee hasn't been extended to this year. So that means that money which is announced could actually be clawed back. And in the past, it's often been clawed back as late on as February or March in the financial year. Now, because I've got to balance my budget to the penny, that means that in February or March, having already confirmed that, for example, teachers would get a certain amount of money or businesses would get a certain amount of money, I'm then left having to repay some of that money to the UK government late on in the financial year. Clearly, I don't have the capacity in a fixed budget to suddenly create more headroom once we've already confirmed that money is being spent. Now, that happened the year before COVID. So in 2020 and in February 2020, we got confirmation that of the money that had been announced to us during the year, actually the amount we were going to get was less. So we then had to repay some of that money. In that case, it was capital, very late in the financial year. So the big question for me is, I can't afford to hold money back, because businesses need it, public services need it. Our citizens need that money in the health service and remobilising the justice system. But equally, in the back of my mind, I've got this fear that money that's announced could be revised down. And it's already happened in education. I think it was £25 million that had been previously announced, actually was clawed back in May. It's easier to handle if it's earlier in the financial year, but if it's in February or March, it's just almost impossible, because we can't borrow. We can't suddenly create additional money to pay it back.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I'm now opening up questions to the committee, and first will be Deputy Convener Daniel Johnson, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you. Can I begin by saying, following on from the Convener's remarks at the beginning of the session, that we can both agree that we both have excellent diction and enunciation. But I really want to sort of follow on from some of the things that have already been raised. And clearly you'll have read that the Spice report and the Fraser Valander looking at the outturn reports and comparing against the tax plans. Now, in the 2019-20 budget, the Scottish Government expected its tax plans to raise an additional £500 million. But based on the outturn, that has only been £148 million. Now, I understand that the things you were hinting at in terms of the block grant mechanism, but what is clear from both of these bodies is that what that fundamentally tells us is that income tax per capita has not grown as much in Scotland as it has in the rest of the UK. So, first of all, I'm just wondering if you agree with that assessment, but more importantly, and given what you were just saying about the need to expand the income tax base, but actually also make sure that people are earning more within that, what does that say about the policies you've been pursuing, and what policies will you pursue to ensure that essentially people are earning more so they pay more tax, which I think we can all agree would be a good thing.
Thanks. So on that first point around the outturn report, and I understand that the premise of your question, I think it is important to reflect that our income tax policies still did raise £148 million over and above the block grant adjustment. In other words, that was £148 million that wouldn't have been secured for the public purse if it hadn't been for the change in policy. And you know, there's two additional points I would make. The first is that we have been clear that our income tax policy is endeavouring to do two things. There's two results that we're seeking to achieve. The first is obviously a security of public revenue. So in order to say that the health service will get X billion over the next year, I need to know that that money's coming in. So we need to be sure that we're going to raise it. But we are also trying to ensure that it's fair. And we've been clear that we had intentionally made changes to maximise the progressivity of income tax. It's not perfect, but then again, we only have powers over rates and bands. We don't have power over the personal allowance, over incentives like gift aid, and over the interaction with things like pensions. So that, I think, it needs to be seen in that context. Having said that, quite clearly, I want to ensure that we do secure the long-term sustainability of our income tax policies. In other words, we continue to ensure that we have the money that we need. We right now are undertaking a policy evaluation to better understand the impact of the 2018-2019 policy reforms. We are hoping to publish the findings later this year on precisely what the impact has been of those policy changes. So I'm sure that will be of interest. We have continued to see COVID accepting a growth in Scottish receipts and exceeding that of the rest of the UK. So this is the second consecutive year that growth in Scottish receipts have exceeded the rest of the UK. We want to see that growth continue. And obviously, we will wait and see what the impact of this COVID year has been. If I could make one third point, though, which is around the risk that all of that creates, because if you look at the reconciliations over the last 2 years, you can see that the fiscal framework is not sufficient right now to deal with that level of volatility in forecast error. So the existing borrowing and reserve powers in the fiscal framework are insufficient right now to deal with that volatility. So I'll stop there, but I think there are three implications of all of this. One is it important that we have more than one objective for fiscal for income tax? Two, is it important that we continue to raise more than we would have from the block grant adjustment? But thirdly, with that level of risk and volatility, what is the best way of using of managing that? And my view is that's where we need to have a broader review of the fiscal framework to ensure that it can deal with that level of volatility.
I mean, I agree we need to get into the detail of the fiscal framework. I don't think we've got time to do that this morning. But I think where there is clear agreement is that we need to essentially be ensuring that on a per capita basis that we're increasing income tax. Because actually, fundamentally, that what that tells us is that people in Scotland are earning more money. And that is a good thing. Indeed, I mean, I think you summed it up quite well earlier on. Essentially, you know, more people participating in the economy, you know, earning more money, and that's fundamentally underpinned by productivity. I guess my concern, and relating to some of the things that the convener was raising, is that to me sounds an awful lot like economic growth. I'm very clear that economic growth is a good thing, especially when it's underpinned by growth in productivity, because it means that people are better off and lead better lives. There are certain people that are about to join your government who think that economic growth is a bad thing. I'm just wondering what the Scottish Government's view is on economic growth.
Well, I can be very open and honest about my view on economic growth, and I should just point out that obviously the cooperation agreement had some excluded areas, and you will find GDP growth in those excluded areas, which I'm sure you've read already. My view on this is that we need fairer and increased prosperity. So you cannot have economic growth without looking at fairness, because that does not secure the outcome that you and I are both talking about here. If we just see a ballooning of the highest earning and the tax revenue that comes from that, and we still see huge levels of in-work poverty, that is not a good result. So economic growth has got to be fair, and it's got to be distributed. How you do that, in my view, is to ensure that the focus of government is in supporting businesses, industries, sectors that will bring more people into safe, secure and well-paid employment. We've seen the implications of that over the pandemic year, where being in employment is a great blessing, but in and of itself is not enough to ensure that you're not in poverty. It's got to be safe, secure and well-paid. I think there's great opportunities in the Scottish economy when it comes to the just transition and the green economy, when it comes to new and emerging technologies, when it comes to alternative forms of energy, and ensuring that each of our local economies are thriving. Because to take a more regional approach, if Edinburgh and Glasgow are doing well, then probably the national picture looks quite healthy. But I tell you, I've got a vested interest in making sure the Highlands are doing well, the south of Scotland are doing well, the areas perhaps of deprivation are doing much better. So when it comes to inclusive, sustained economic growth, we have got to make sure that it's fair, and it's not just economic growth for the sake of it.
Thank you. I almost completely agree with everything you've just set out there. We do need growth, and because ultimately that should lead to greater fairness and greater prosperity for people. My only concern is that I think that you and I might agree more than you agree with some of your new ministers, but I'll leave that there. Just the final point is, discussing earlier on this morning with the Fiscal Commission their forecast. On the one hand, they look very encouraging, that we will return to pre-COVID levels by quarter two of 2022, which is a good deal earlier than we expected. But I think talking with them, that there are a number of risks. And indeed, one of the things they said was, assuming that the current relative absence of restrictions is maintained. Now, given the events of recent weeks, I think we're all concerned about the levels of infections. There has been, and understandably, talk of circuit breakers and the possibility, at the very least, of restrictions being reimposed. I'm just wondering what work is being undertaken within the Scottish Government to look at what the impact of those might be, how that would impact spending within the current year, and whether or not you could outline what the fiscal consequences might be of a circuit breaker or any other interventions that might be required if the situation doesn't improve.
Thanks for that question. A really good question. And the SFC forecasts are a cause for optimism. I don't think we can downplay the difference between the January forecasts, which I had to base my budget on, and were really tough outlook for the Scottish economy, reflecting the huge impact of the pandemic versus where we are now. And they are but forecasts based on, I'm sure, various variables that the SFC would have gone into, vaccinations, lockdowns, other things. In terms of the fiscal impact, one of the biggest challenges right now from a financial perspective is the fact that there hasn't been that much additional consequential funding from the UK government in the last few months. So we right now are trying to remobilise the health service, remobilise the justice system, remobilise a whole host of different public services, as well as deal with the ongoing COVID impact from a budget that has not been supplemented supplemented by additional consequentials coming from the UK government in the way that it was last year. And at the moment, the pressures on the Scottish budget are such that we really, really need the sort of structural supports for businesses to be in place. Furlough, self-employed income support. If we were to find ourselves going into another lockdown, and at the moment, that's not what we're discussing. At the moment, we're talking about trying to maximise the impact of the baseline measures. But if we were to, then we have no certainty that furlough will be in place. We have no certainty that self-employed income supports will be in place. And I have no certainty that there will be any additional funding in place. And I am not sitting on funds right now that I could deploy to support businesses. We would need additional help from the UK government. There's a bit of a deja vu, I think, with last October, where furlough was due to come to an end. We asked repeatedly for it to be extended. Now, it was extended at the last minute, but the Scottish Government's resources are just not sufficient to help businesses to the level that they need to be supported through furlough and self-employed income support. So we would need to ask the UK Government for additional help, because it would require funding on a scale that we cannot provide in light of the need to balance and fix our budget. I cannot borrow for those emergencies that you're talking about.
Okay, John, to be followed by Liz.
Thanks so much, convener. And one of the subjects we talked quite a lot about with the Fiscal Commission was the question of inflation. And they seem to be following now the Bank of England projections, which are more recent, I think 2.5% falling from the present 4%. And they seemed reasonably relaxed about inflation in that, you know, if we had to pay out more, we'd get more in by way of tax and so on. And I just wonder if you're relaxed about inflation or if it is a concern for yourself and for the budgets.
Yes, these matters are always a concern in the sense that they are one of the many variables that we're dealing with as we try and manage our budget. I said already that this year's budget feels extremely challenging because there is the need to remobilise our services, there's the need to deal with the ongoing COVID implications. There are a number of pay deals being negotiated that are multi-year, and we also are dealing with the probably more challenging outlook of funding from the UK government. So they are hopefully going to publish a comprehensive spending review of multi-year. But clearly, we when it comes to the biggest impact of inflation, it is trying to understand what our costs will be and whether there is sufficient budget to deal with those costs. And because we don't have, not to sound like a broken record, but because I have limited powers to increase capacity when it's needed. So, for example, if inflation was to rise considerably, meaning that our budget doesn't go as far as it needs to go, I can't suddenly increase. So if I take our capital, our budget, if I take the affordable housing programme that Kenny Gibson talked about at the outset, trying to budget for that and trying to understand what the costs will be is where I'm most challenged, because the UK government or any government around the world that is dealing with these fluctuating costs can make the appropriate changes to either borrowing or other areas, whereas all I can do is cut the cake differently. I can't increase the size of the cake to deal with increased costs. And clearly, when it comes to pay deals, workforces will be looking for adequate recompense for their labours, and there will be inflationary implications. So inflation is a very important reference for those pay negotiations. And if UK government pay is flatter, then obviously we don't get the additional consequentials from that either. Sorry, that was a very long and waffly answer, but there's quite a few ways in which inflation has an impact, and it's something that we are monitoring carefully.
Thanks. No, I appreciate that, because I think it is an important issue. I lived through kind of higher inflation some years ago, and it does concern me very much. Another area that the SFC was more positive about was the long-term scarring effect of COVID, which they had thought was going to be greater, I think, around 3% of the economy, and now they're saying 2%. Are these figures you recognise and you would agree with?
Well, they are very helpful figures, and we have been for the last year, obviously in discussion with the chief economist, looking at the ways in which COVID would have long-term impact. And, you know, I think it was as early as probably last summer that we were looking at very much a K recovery. In other words, and I think I've spoken to the Finance Committee before about this, where we saw some businesses and some sectors were doing relatively well, comparatively well. New businesses being created. If I take one industry, the tech sector, obviously booming. And then clearly other sectors doing really, really struggling. And so that it's good to see the SFC's figures, which suggest that there is going to be less long-term scarring. I think there are some sectors, though, that will probably be dealing with that scarring longer than other sectors. So whilst the national picture might be more optimistic, there are probably sections of our economy that will need help for longer and might see longer-term scarring than other sectors. So I think it's a different picture when you break it down sectorally.
Yeah, that was also a point that the SFC made about the different sectors recovering in different ways. They were slightly more negative about non-domestic rates. I mean, they're forecasting lower than they had previously thought in January. And I think 27 million lower this year, 34, 48 going forward. I mean, again, is that inevitable? Is that just a result of COVID, do you think?
No, I think there is an impact of COVID, and also recognising the fact that we have maintained that 100% rates relief for a full year. So we are tracking that. Obviously, it's one reason why our guarantee when it comes to local government is so important, because of the fluctuations in non-domestic rates. And south of the border, where non-domestic rates are see a dip, then local government is exposed to that. Whereas in Scotland, there is a more of a guarantee around local government getting the income that we confirm they will receive.
Thanks. And the final area I wanted to touch on was social security spending. The SFC have made forecasts that the adult disability payment, which is replacing PIP, is likely to cost some 500 million more. And, you know, they're warning that if we're putting more money into social security, that will have to be balanced off somewhere else in the budget. Are they being over pessimistic there, do you think, or have you got these figures in your budgets?
Well, 2 points. I suppose whether or not I agree with the SFC, the value of the SFC's forecast is that I've got to live with them. So I've got to live with their within their forecasts, particularly for revenue, but also for spend. And that's another area, just going back to your earlier question, where there are impacts of increased inflation or higher inflation, or monitoring the inflation. But we will continue to provide that support, which we are obliged to do, which is quite right for demand-led payments. Not to sound like a broken record, but it's precisely why that level of volatility needs the requisite tools to manage it, because it is a risk. Any demand-led payments create a risk for the Scottish Government in terms of managing within our fixed and balanced budget. And so the SFC are right in saying that I cannot increase the size of the cake, so one slice of the cake is bigger than originally intended, then it does need to come from elsewhere in the Scottish Government. And that is the level of risk and volatility that I have to manage it within a balanced and fixed budget.
I mean, just maybe to final just on that point, I mean, I'm totally in favour that we should have a more generous social security system than the UK has, but it does come at a cost. And I mean, to some extent, whether we're independent or not, it will be demand led. So I guess we're always going to have to manage that. Is that right?
That's right. Yeah, I would agree with you. It is the nature of it. It is demand demand led, and we make a big effort in promoting uptake because we believe it's right for people to get the help that they need. And so clearly that has an impact on demand and an impact on the budget. And you know, we will fund that need and that demand because it's important that as a fair and kind society we protect the most vulnerable.
Thank you very much.
Liz, to be followed by Michelle.
Thank you and good morning. Can I turn our attention back to economic growth, which I think maybe with one political party exception, I think is very important, and it's in line with what you were saying in your last budget speech and in some of the questions you answered in the last Parliament, where you said that business wants certainty and it wants a predictability in terms of planning ahead, and you know, it wants to know exactly where it's going. Could I ask you first, what plans does the Scottish Government have in relation to working with the UK Government about access to cash and banking services?
I will work with the UK Government constructively on every issue that is of importance to the people of Scotland. So business support and other support. The difficulty we face right now is bluntly a complete lack of clarity on what is happening. So where, for example, if we take something like Greenports, Freeports, which has a direct impact on local areas, I say that just speaking to you down the road from the Cromarty Port Firth Authority. So there's a direct impact. And our problem is not a lack of engagement or a lack of constructive engagement, just not getting a solution or a resolution. We had hoped for a resolution on that one in March budget, in the March budget this year. So were the Welsh and the Northern Irish expecting, and it hasn't come. So the same would apply to things like the levelling up agenda and funding that might come through that or otherwise. It's less to do with constructive engagement, and it's nearly always to do with a lack of clarity. There was a newspaper headline last week, I think it was, on suggesting that we had rejected millions of pounds, which was news to me, because actually, for the most part, just a complete lack of clarity or engagement. And even for local authorities, if you're engaging with local authorities, you'll know that it feels a bit like a lottery to them at the moment of engaging with the levelling up agenda. They don't know if they'll get money, they don't know if they, you know, what the process is precisely. So, you know, I will engage constructively, but it really helps to know precisely what's happening and not getting pulled in at the very, very 11th hour.
I mean, and there are obviously some of these schemes like the levelling up that you've just mentioned that are extremely important, and that can be government-led. But there is a cash flow problem for many businesses in Scotland, just as there is in the rest of the UK. And I just wonder what discussions, this is not a political question, what discussions are happening between the two governments about how to improve access to cash and banking services, because that is absolutely critical to a lot of the survival in the future for many businesses.
Thanks for clarifying that question. Engagement on the banking point is happening quite extensively. So we do that through we've got the banking forum. So we've got where we engage with banks and engage with UK government. In terms of the nitty gritty of how it happens, I have had quadrilateral meetings with my counterparts in Wales, Northern Ireland, and the UK government, where at the last one the agenda included access to loan funding and what the banks were doing or not doing that we would like them to do. So there is that engagement directly in, you know, actual face-to-face conversation with the UK government on banking. In terms of access to cash, we have made the point about extending some of the schemes that we think should be extended, but there is a general commitment to work together on supporting businesses. particularly as the point, you know, I think it was the Scottish Financial Enterprise said that businesses are facing a wall of liabilities right now as they look ahead. So that point was we discussed at length at the last quadrilateral meeting with the Chief Secretary and my counterparts in the other devolved governments.
Okay, thank you. And just on the infrastructure angle, which again you've referred to previously, I mean, good quality infrastructure is absolutely critical to economic growth and to ensuring that business has some certainty and can plan ahead. I just want to ask you about two things. Firstly, there have been reports that because of the new deal between the SNP and the Greens, some of that infrastructure planning that the SNP previously were committed to might be in jeopardy. So could you just comment on that? And secondly, there was a report, I think, just at the weekend there, that some money which had been offered to the Scottish Government for road improvement infrastructure hadn't been used. Is that correct?
So on the capital point, we obviously published our capital spending review last year. We had originally we knowingly published it before the UK government published their spending review. Their spending review is due in the autumn. So it would have been the case anyway that we would have had to look at our spending review, our capital spending review, our multi-year commitment to infrastructure in light of what the UK government publishes. So that will be the case. Clearly, we have to factor in what capital we receive and what our commitments are. But our commitments still stand. We have not rolled back on our published commitments when it comes to capital investment. And that is all subject to what capital is allocated to Scotland as part of the spending review. Do you want to come back on that?
I just want to, that's interesting that you say that, because obviously that's contrary to some of the reports that we were getting, but as Cabinet Secretary for Finance, do you feel that there is a really strong commitment there from the Scottish Government that the infrastructure projects that were announced will go ahead, because I think, you know, business and industry is looking to them as being extremely important, particularly in terms of connectivity and accessibility. You know, we've had a huge fuss, as you know, just nothing to do with the Scottish Government, about, you know, ScotRail commitments changing services and whatever, and, you know, people very anxious about the lack of connectivity and increased journey times and things, whereas the projects that the SNP had committed to were trying to address some of these connectivity issues, and therefore I'm just asking if you can give a commitment that these will go ahead, because they're obviously extremely important to Scotland.
They are extremely important, and my commitment to them going ahead is subject to a massive issue that I don't have control over, which is when we published our spending review last autumn, we said we're going ahead of the UK government. We're basing these proposals on the best available evidence that we have at the time, but we are publishing ahead of the UK government spending review. So in autumn, I really hope that the Chancellor publishes his multi-year spending review. Capital has to be multi-year. You know, you can't lurch from year to year with your capital plans. So what we did last year was in good faith, based on the best available evidence, that when he publishes his capital review, what I will be looking for is to make sure that what we have committed to can be funded by what we are given, and we will need to, you know, we will need to make sure that there is money coming in for the money to go out.
Yes,
and more influence.
I totally understand that, Cabinet Secretary. I'm just interested that in terms of the deal with the Greens, whether, you know, if the Greens were to come along and say that, you know, one price of the deal was that one aspect of the infrastructure development might not go ahead. Is that something that could jeopardise any of these projects? Because I think, you know, that would be a big concern to many people, particularly in more rural aspects of Scotland.
Yeah. And if you're obviously everything related to the Green Deal has been now published, and we have not sacrificed our commitments. So the A9 is still going to be dualled. The A96 is referred to in the cooperation agreement in terms of the priorities for the next few years. So as far as I'm concerned, as somebody who represents a rural area, there are no consequences for the project. As a local MSP, I'm fighting for. Usually I'll lobby myself, and that doesn't work very well, but I'm fighting for local investment in local communities, and that will continue to be the case. So I guess what I'm trying to say in a roundabout way is the biggest impact is not deals. The biggest impact is just having the cash. and the actual hard money to invest. So I'll pause there because I did want to talk about the report about missing out on funding. And I was quite confused by that because there's a real irony at the heart of the report, which was essentially that the UK government is using the Internal Markets Bill to try and spend directly in areas of devolved competence and then saying we're not engaging sufficiently. And I think the irony is that having joined the Welsh and the Northern Irish and saying that it is an attack on devolved competence, then to be accused of not engaging sufficiently seems quite ironic. And our big problem with levelling up for the unionisation of spend is that we are usually kept in the dark. Occasionally we're brought into the light to be told what's happening, and that's a rare experience as far as I'm concerned. But it's really difficult to prioritise your spend when you've got another government spending in devolved areas. Now, local authorities are all, as far as I can see, considering whether or not to bid for things like Levelling Up Fund. And, you know, there's a big question for us. So if at the heart of COSLA's methodology, to just use that as an example, is a point around fairness of distribution. So every local authority gets a fair share of the capital that's available. If some areas are getting substantially more directly from the UK government, does that mean that we compensate the other local authorities with our capital? So other local authorities get the capital that would have otherwise been shared fairly across local authorities. And where we're already spending in, for example, some of the key roads that I think were referred to in that news report, if they're now getting money directly from the UK government, should we use that funding for other priority projects that haven't yet been funded? So it's extremely difficult to determine how to use limited capital funding as far as we can on hospitals, projects, roads, schools, when the UK government is making decisions about capital spend that we are not cited on. So, I think it was David Duguid that made the comment on missing out on money. I've not rejected any money. I'm not aware of ever rejecting any money. Scotland needs as much investment as possible, but equally it seems a bit rich to accuse us of not engaging when they're actually trampling over the normal devolved processes for distributing funding.
Okay, we'll leave it there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Michelle to follow by Douglas.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You actually very neatly led into one of my questions, which is concerning the very alarming statements from the Fraser of Allender Institute in the first version of the report, which you'll know about for the ESRC, which they said the effect is to circumvent not only the Barnett formula, but the devolved governments themselves. So I was very interested to hear about some of the implications of the spend coming in left field, if you like. And my question to you is, have you given further detailed consideration to a range of different scenarios where that could undoubtedly both have unintended consequences, but potentially undesirable consequences as well, both in your ability to control and manage the budget and to deliver on your policy imperatives?
Thanks for that. And just to clarify, are you talking specifically about things like replacement for EU funding,
yes,
and levelling up and so on and so forth?
The general new, yeah, funding streams, levelling up, community renewal, UK shared prosperity and so on.
Yeah. So I think there's three issues, if I could break them down like this. The first is the lack of clarity. And I know I've already mentioned that, but The lack of clarity on how some of these schemes are currently operating or will operate, or how they are accessed by communities, local government and others, is extremely unhelpful. So even before I get into the territory of saying that the UK government shouldn't be interfering in devolved areas, we are faced with trying to prioritise a lot of infrastructure projects that are so important to communities. I've already said hospitals, roads and otherwise. And the lack of clarity means some of these communities, some of these local authorities don't know if they will secure capital funding through these alternative routes. So So I can think of one in my own local authority area where it's a transport infrastructure. They are considering going after levelling up, and they're also lobbying us for funding. So what do I do? Do I allocate that funding, not knowing if they'll get alternative sources of funding, knowing that if they do get an alternative source, could that money then be used for another community? So that lack of clarity is making our financial decision-making process extremely convoluted, and it's not giving local communities and local government the certainty that they need. The second point is one of fairness, because, again, right at the heart of the methodology when it comes to local government is this point of fairness. I can't announce any schemes or any funds without COSLA telling me quite rightly that it should be fared equally across local authority areas. So one local authority area is getting substantial additional funding through the Levelling Up Fund, and the others aren't. Do I use that funding that I have to compensate those, or do we still share it over equally? And will those local authorities that haven't secured funding be content with that? So there's a point there about clarity. The second thing, though, which is really important, is that, that right now it will not, in any shape or form, compensate for the loss of EU funding. So this assumption that it will is totally flawed. If I think of the Highlands, where I'm speaking to you from right now, an area that has disproportionately benefited from EU funding because of its rurality, because of its deprivation, because of the transport distances, levelling up funding is not going to compensate. Shared prosperity funding is not going to compensate for the loss of that EU funding. And the additional complex routes to funding, where it is essentially a lottery, are going to make it even worse. And the third point I'd make is that I don't believe that this will be additional. So last budget, the UK government chancellor talked at length about the additional capital spend on infrastructure across the UK. And in the same breath, announced a budget for Scotland that saw our capital budget cut by 5%. I have posed the question, well, my counterparts in Wales have posed the question to the Chief Secretary in the past as to whether all this capital will be additional or whether we will see a net decrease in our own budget as it's redeployed through alternative routes. And the silence has been deafening, but I think what we've seen in last year's budget on capital is that the increase in what UK-wide spend is seeing a decrease in the Scottish Government's capital budget, which means that money will be spent on, I don't know, pet projects or whatever the UK government is choosing to prioritise. But there's an actual tangible impact on our own capital budget, which is spent on schools, it's spent on hospitals, it's spent on roads. So those would be my three primary concerns, that the convoluted process and lack of clarity is undermining the certainty of making plans, and it's leading to increased fairness in unfairness across Scotland. That secondly, it's no compensation for EU funding. And thirdly, there will be an equal and opposite decrease in the Scottish budget, the Scottish Government's budget, that goes directly on hospitals and roads, etc.
Well, thank you for all these points. I want to move on to something else, which I'd just like a bit more information. I think it would be of general interest to everyone. You mentioned in your letter this morning, thank you, that you plan to launch Scotland's first framework for tax. It would be helpful for you to share what additional information you can about that. I'm just generally interested in the discussion we had about tax last week.
Yes, so the new framework for tax supplements the Scottish approach to taxation, which is our policy framework for how we make tax policy. And it is inviting stakeholder views on how we can better design and deliver tax policy in Scotland. So clearly, the devolution of income tax and other taxes is still relatively new. And tax stakeholders continue to tell me that engagement and understanding of devolved taxes still needs to be built and developed. So the framework is trying to put more flesh on the bone of our approach to taxation. It builds on what we have said before, but it also is inviting views on how we improve the design and the delivery of tax, inviting comments from stakeholders. I hope it might also raise broader awareness of devolved and local tax powers, which are still relatively new.
And there may well be a residual benefit to help the larger public understand the perhaps dog's dinner that is the current fiscal framework, as a by-the-by. The other thing I wanted to ask you about is actually to do with local government. They, as you know, they have very similar challenges in terms of at what point they can be confident about money appearing and so on. And in terms of the review of capital accounting, which I think you requested, it's been led by directors of finance on behalf of local government. I wondered were able to express any views on the extent to which the focus should be on understanding service concession flexibilities to facilitate financial planning, or do you intend to wait for the outcome of the review before local councils can get some more certainty about flexibilities they have?
Thanks for the question. It's an area that local government has been raising with me quite frequently. 2 points. One is that we aren't waiting for the outcome of that review to try and provide local government with certainty now. And there was a request that we provide additional certainty now, and I've confirmed to COSLA that I'm content to do so. So COSLA had raised the English model, where proactively, prospectively, they could make changes to capital accounting. And we have obviously already moved in terms of giving a 2-year additional flexibility on that. And I've also confirmed to COSLA that I'm willing to extend that further in the same vein as the English model can, where councils have additional discretion on what is model to use. I think it's still important that we have the review, however, because I think there's questions about what is the most prudent and sustainable approach over the long term, and making sure that it's consistent with not just other public bodies, but with accounting standards as well.
And just the last question, thank you very much. Just picking up on something that Liz Smith said in terms of the debt burden of small businesses, could I ask, when you're having your conversations with the UK government, that they implore on banks the need for flexibility in some of the loan schemes that are there? There are some protections in place, for example, no PGs for CBILS loans and so on up to a certain amount. But the fact remains that post-2008 recession saw some really poor behaviour by banks in terms of forcing SMEs in particular into very distressed circumstances where they were then made bankrupt or sequestrated. So could I ask that you add your voice to that banks are made to understand their obligations to SME community in particular? Thank you.
Absolutely. Those are issues that have been raised with the UK government, and I will continue to raise them, but also to raise them directly with banks, because we have a very good and constructive relationship with the banks in Scotland, who I think over the last crisis have actually been quite helpful. But the real test is now, when it comes to that wall of liabilities and how they help businesses through the next few years when repayment of bounce back loans, CBILS, etc., will not be required or is written required.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Douglas.
Thank you, Vina. Hello, Cabinet Secretary. The SFC are predicting a 17% rise in non-domestic rates between 2022, 23 and 26, 27. And we have a revaluation next year. And with the changes to certain sectors like retail and commercial, do you think that sort of rise is going to be achievable? Because a lot of businesses will be thinking, where's that money going to come from?
Yeah, and just to be clear, and I might ask if Dougie wants to come in on this as well, around the around non-domestic rates, that doesn't indicate that there will be a 17% increase in the tax rate, obviously. It just is referring, hopefully, to the strength of the business community as well, in terms of business survival rates and business growth. Clearly, Scotland right now has the lowest poundage rate in the UK. That means we're delivering a lower tax for over 95% of properties, and they get that here in Scotland. So when it comes to the next few years, we have got to make sure that we continue to provide that certainty to business and to try and allow them the headroom to recover. That was the reason this year for extending that 100% rates relief, because knowing that they are not paying non-domestic rates hopefully allows them to recover and to use that funding that they would otherwise be paying in tax to invest in their businesses or to see through the rest of the challenge that we face. In terms of the revaluation, I know there was a lot of discussion about the revaluation. One of my primary reasons for scheduling the revaluation when we have is in order to allow the impact of the pandemic to actually be seen in rental values. My fear in going too soon, and I know the North East has a particular reason for why the revaluation should be earlier rather than later in light of the big economic challenges that the North East faces, but the reason was to ensure that rental values had had filtered down and the revaluation was a fair revaluation. Going too soon could have meant that the rental values hadn't changed. People were not, for example, rewriting their tenancy agreements. They were waiting until after the pandemic to do that. So my hope is that with the next revaluation, it will be a lot fairer in terms of taking into account the actual impact of the pandemic, and the rateable values will reflect the impact of the pandemic, and therefore they will pay a fairer amount in taxation. But happy to take follow-ups on that, and that probably covers it. Dougie probably doesn't need to come in unless he really wants to. Mm.
Another question I have is around the NDR pool, which now stands at a deficit of 192 million. So what impact is that going to have to businesses as we move forward through the pandemic? Because that, I guess, will have to be repaid back into the pool.
Yeah, and it's good to have a question on non-domestic rates pool, and it probably reflects your own wealth of experience as a local councillor. So on the non-domestic rates pool, that shouldn't have an impact on businesses directly. So the non-domestic rates pool is our way of managing the risks to public finances from non-domestic rates. So you will know, because we've been in conversation before about this, and when it comes to local government spend, we guarantee the amount of non-domestic rates that local authority receives. Now, in some years, that means that you and the North East are saying that's not fair. In other years, when it comes to, for example, the pandemic, it means that local authorities can budget with certainty and security. But the way that we manage the potential fluctuations in non-domestic rates from year to year is through the pool. So it will not have an impact on business. It doesn't influence or inform my view on what rate of taxation to implement. My interest is trying to make sure that Scotland is as competitive as possible when it comes to the poundage, and our non-domestic rates pool is just our means of balancing the account from year to year.
But to balance it, I would imagine that the intake is going to have to increase to pay that 192 million deficit.
So it's a case of reconciling forecasts with outturn. Mm-hmm. So at the beginning of the year, the SFC will forecast what they think we will receive in non-domestic rates. We plan what we will spend on public services on the basis of that forecast. But clearly, forecasts are just forecasts. They could the outturn, the amount that we receive in non-domestic rates, could be higher, it could be lower. So it is a balancing account to manage and to ensure that we can meet our commitment to spend X million, for example, on the health service. Because at the end of the day, it is just a forecast that we base our budget on, not the actual amount of tax take.
Okay, so I guess, Cabinet Secretary, so if we've if we've had that estimate been wrong for the last 3 years, how confident are you it'll be right for the next 4 years?
Well, fairly confident in that the FSC are good at their job, but clearly this is a time of huge uncertainty. So John Mason asked earlier about whether, or somebody else asked earlier about whether there were other issues that needed to be factored in, it was Daniel Johnson, for example, in a further lockdown. So there's a lot of uncertainties right now in terms of the performance of our economy. And clearly that has an impact on tax take. So 2 years ago, I couldn't have foreseen that we would be implementing a full year of non-domestic rates relief at 100%. Just can't foresee it. And I think right now there's quite a lot of volatility. So the SFC and others, they're very good at their job. They do the best forecast they can. I can't deviate from that forecast. I must spend within that forecast. Whether I think it's right or I think it's wrong, I must spend within that forecast. But from year to year, that forecast will be out of, you know, no forecast is perfectly and completely aligned to the outturn. So it means that there will be some addition and some reduction. But again, happy to bring Dougie in, who, if he wants to come in, but that probably, hopefully, answers your question. The forecast will never be exactly right, but I have confidence that the SFC know what they're doing.
Does not come in.
Yeah, nothing much to add. I mean, I think if I've understood your question correctly, Mr. Lumsden, we've got a shared understanding of the non-domestic rates pool. And you know the forecast, it's just a forecast, isn't it? And it will never be exactly right. So given it's a balancing account, from year to year, the NDR pool will always be either in deficit or in surplus from year to year. And we try to balance it from year to year.
Okay. Thank you. If I can continue, the SNP Green Deal has been mentioned earlier. And Cabinet Secretary, just do you see any consequences to the oil and gas industry from the deal that's been proposed? I know that a lot of people in the North East especially are very nervous about this, especially when we see a future member of the government saying to, you know, if you work in oil and gas, you should be looking for a new job. So that doesn't inspire confidence going forward. What's your view on, you know, whether people in the oil and gas industry or jobs are safe? Because it's still, you know, a big piece to the Scottish economy.
My answer to that would be that workers in the oil and gas industry have some of the most critical skills that our economy needs over the coming years. My commitment is to ensure that they have access to skilled work that reflects their talents and their capabilities. I think across the world, every society, every government is grappling with what a just transition looks like. From my view, a just transition means a fair transition, and we don't leave people behind. And therefore, right now, there are huge opportunities on the horizon. There are huge opportunities as part of that just transition when it comes to renewables. The oil and gas industry is already grappling with this themselves. And irrespective of what I or my government says, we've had 18 months of a global reduction in demand, which has seen a lot of people concerned for their jobs and therefore the wider supply chain, which you will be more versed in than I am, the wider supply chain being concerned about what their future holds. I think government's job is to try and provide that certainty by looking at how we diversify an economy which has been impacted by issues outside our control. Nobody could have foreseen COVID. Nobody could have foreseen the perhaps renewed and intense focus on the climate emergency. So our job is to make sure that every individual working in oil and gas right now who have some of the most important skills internationally continue to be able to use those skills in a meaningful and a secure job. And in so doing, ensure that the North East continues to be a vitally important contributor to the national Scottish economy.
Okay. And last question, Cabinet Secretary, is It was mentioned earlier that the Social Security bill was going to rise from $3.7 billion to $5.2 billion, and that's without adding in some of the SNP manifesto pledges. Does it concern you, that rate of increase, in a relatively short space of time?
And trying to ensure that we have a sufficient budget for commitments is clearly an issue that certainly dominates my attention, and Social Security is no different, to make sure that as part of the cake of funding, we are cutting it in a way that is fair. I don't think anybody could disagree that as we emerge from the pandemic, that are some individuals and sections of society that have been more exposed to the impact of the pandemic than others. So inequalities have been exacerbated. And I think in the same way as my job is to try and help businesses through this tumultuous time and give them the support they need, so the same in the same spirit, helping families through. It's one of the reasons that we wanted to help local government to freeze council tax to ensure that there was more money in people's pockets. And clearly the social security system has got to help people who need it, when they need it, with a view to either helping them get back on their feet or at least ensuring that we tackle child poverty. So in terms of the premise, it's not a concern in that I think it's important to do, but we do ultimately need to make sure that there's the funding in place. And when it comes to the budget, and I'm sure I'll be in front of the committee again in the not too distant future to talk about the budget, when it comes to the budget, we have choices about what to prioritise. We can't create new money, so what to be prioritised within the budget that we have.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much. Thanks to members of the committee. I've just a couple of questions to kind of wind up with. One is in regard to capital budget. Now, raw material prices are growing between 5 and 15% a year. Now, you said that the agreement with the Greens would not threaten the delivery of Scotland's capital projects that are already committed to, but clearly, if there's significant pressure on the capital budget because of inflation, then that may make it more difficult to deliver some of these projects. So can I ask what discussions you've had with the UK government regarding perhaps an uplift to the Scottish Government's capital programme budget?
Yes, I obviously regularly engage with the UK government, and I firmly believe that one of the most powerful levers we have when it comes to economic recovery is capital investment in infrastructure. It creates jobs, it supports businesses, and it's good for local communities. So it's a triple win as far as I'm concerned. Because our primary source of funding is the UK government, that is the primary means by which I'm trying to secure additional capital. And I think capital is one of the areas of greatest risk when I look at the future right now, because of the unionisation of spend and the internal markets bill. So it's an area which I continue to press for additional security over, certainty over, and a plea that we do invest in infrastructure over the coming years as a way of recovering well and recovering better.
Okay, and when I asked the question about the deferred possibility of deferred funding, members asked about, for example, the impact it would be on a number of areas of the Scottish budget, and you talked about how difficult it was, as did members, of, for example, additional funding coming in at a time when, you know, local authorities were agreeing their own budgets, council tax being settlement being agreed, etc. But if we're in a situation, and I hope we're not, because I hope the UK government will do as it's done previously, and I agree to carry over if necessary, do you have any kind of shovel-ready type projects in terms of providing additional support for businesses or other areas of the economy, should we get into that situation so that money is used effectively?
The short answer is yes, but the way that we budget is try and get a sense for the full year. What we don't want in our budget is that we spend and then have to save because suddenly money is getting cut, and then at the last minute getting more money, so we have to spend. It's a really ineffective way of budgeting. So the way that my team and I manage the year's budget is to try and get a sense from every portfolio of what they want to do, what they want to achieve. And clearly, for most of these projects, they're not just in 1 year. They're multi-year projects. You know, building a new hospital is multi-year. So you can't just turn on the tap for 2 months and hope that that delivers a project. So we try and manage that demand over a longer period of time, because very few projects can be delivered with just a month's extra funding in 1 year. The key is being able to carry forward. The key is being able to manage our money over several years, because having that arbitrary break at the end of the financial year and not being allowed to carry capital forward leads to very ineffective budgeting by spending it in 1 month when you should really be spending it over several months in the next financial year.
Thank you, and that neatly allows me to segue on to your letter to the committee of the 8th of July, when the Scottish Government indicated it started work to support a potential multi-year resource spending review concluding in the autumn. So I'm just wondering where we are currently with that. Is it on schedule, and will it be informed by the fiscal framework review?
Yes and no, but its biggest, component, or the biggest ingredient, the most important ingredient, is UK government spending review. So last year, as I said already, we proceeded with a capital spending review, even though we didn't have a capital spending review from UK government. And there's just a lot of inherent risk in that, because it is our primary source of funding. So when it comes to our own resource spending review, we are undertaking internal work right now to develop a sustainable multi-year financial plans. I know that it is of great importance to local government and other bodies, including the NHS, that be able to plan on a multi-year basis rather than lurching from year to year. Often local government, for example, have third sector organisations who want that multi-year commitment, and they can't get it. So that internal work is ongoing. We haven't taken a final view on publication timeline, because so much of it depends on whether or not the UK government does publish its own comprehensive spending review in the autumn. But you know, once we have more clarity on that, I would commit to fulfilling our commitment, certainly, to set out a framework in advance of a spending review, and to engage with yourselves, as well as wider stakeholders, to inform that final document.
Thank you. And you wrote to the committee just this morning, early this morning, regarding a number of matters. The heading of the letter was "Process and Timetable Around the Scottish Budget 22-23. And you touched on the delayed medium-term financial strategy, and you said, in a quote, "There is logic for publishing the MTFS alongside the Scottish Budget and thereby basing it on the updated SFC and OBR forecasts. Publishing it before the OBR October forecast would mean having to use OBR forecasts from March, the effect of which would be to give a misleading sense of fiscal outlook." And when I raised that matter with the Scottish Fiscal Commission, they actually kind of agreed with that. So kind of where are we in terms of the MTFS? Are we going to see that alongside the budget? And I wonder if you get any further thoughts on the timing of the budget, given all the stramash which you've outlined in your letter regarding the difficulty in not having confirmed timings for UK fiscal events.
Thanks. So we'll start with the MTFS and then move on to the wider budget timetable. Clearly, the original intention would have been to publish in May, but due to the elections, that was not possible. So I would be quite interested too in what the committee's view is on that. There is an ongoing uncertainty because of the UK government's plan for a spending review. Their spending review would be very, very helpful to inform our medium-term financial strategy, because otherwise it is just forecast on the basis of best available evidence. It's not actually based on the latest data from the UK government. There's no perfect timing options, I think, given that the MTFS couldn't be published in May. And it doesn't make sense to publish the MTFS in advance of OBR forecasts. So if OBR forecasts are published on the 26th of October, or we have a promised UK spending review, then you know, I think it would be quite misleading to rely on OBR forecasts from the previous March. And there's been a lot of movement. There continues to be a lot of movement in our economic and our fiscal outlook. And so block grant adjustments that were based on March forecasts would significantly overstate our budget. So that is the territory that I'm in just now. I'm really happy to take the committee's view on how we can spread out scrutiny of the budget, the MTFS, the resource spending review, in a way that allows you to give it the appropriate attention that it needs. And I'd be open to your views on how I can best work with the committee on that. I would intend, certainly, for the 2022 MTFS to revert back to its previous publication timetable in May. That's in line with the written agreement. So hopefully that gives enough information without me actually concluding a position right now, and you can perhaps take a view on that. In terms of the budget timetable, we've obviously had 2 years of quite significant delayed budgets. And we still, there's no perfect time, because if the UK government publishes its budget first, then we have the best available evidence that we need. But if there's any delays to the UK government's budget, then we're left of a position of choosing whether to take inadequate and inaccurate information and base a budget on that in order to give security and certainty to businesses and local government, or whether to wait and increase the delay of giving that certainties to local government, etc., but to have the best available evidence. I would very much like to this year revert to what we formerly did, which would be to consider a budget in late autumn.
Yes, thanks. I mean, one of the things you've said in your letter is that the Chancellor has publicly asked for the Office for Budget Responsibility to produce forecasts on the 27th of October. So does that mean you believe there's likely to be a budget in mid-November or soon after?
That would be my hope. But, you know, we really need the UK government to confirm that. We need the Chancellor to confirm that. And until he confirms that, I'm working off hints and suggestions and indications rather than anything more concrete.
OK, well, thank you very much for that. We'll certainly deliberate over that in our next private session, which is just about to start in a few minutes when we consider our work programme. So I'd like to thank both our guests today, and particularly the Cabinet Secretary, for answering so many questions in such depth, particularly after a previous session at the Local Government Committee. I realise it's been a very heavy morning for you, so hope you'll have a wee break now before the rest of the day's proceedings. So without further ado, I'm going to take the next item in private. So I now end the public session of the committee, and we'll come back in 5 minutes.